It's the lockdown summer. An enticing program of summer visits has been put on hold. There's no holiday in Devon, no day trip to John Mass's Midland Garden, and no evening visits to Yorkshire's secret corners. One of those visits, to see Liz and Rosemary's garden in Boston Spa, wasn't completely lost. And that was because they kindly invited me to go and film their gardens, create a glimpse of what we might have seen on that June evening. The initial idea, to go on the very same day as the planned visit, didn't quite come off. The weather saw to that. Just a few days later, we found ourselves basking in a heat wave. So off I went, on Midsummer Day, to Boston Spa.
Hello.
Oh, good morning, Liz.
Welcome.
Lovely day for it.
It is, isn't it?
My first visit was to Liz Hall's garden at Briley House. Just 3 years ago, her garden looked like this. He asked Liz to show me around.
This is your front border. This is on the north side of the house, isn't it?
Yes, well, it's northeast facing, so that's quite nice. It gets some sun in the early morning, in the summer. So I planned this one first because this was available, whereas the garden at the back hadn't been created yet, so it was just rough grass.
Okay, so would you like to show me some of the plants in the bed?
Yeah, so we've got Roma here, which is a good doer. We've got a Campanula glomerulata caroline there. It's a lovely purpley colour. Geranium patricia and geranium summer skies. And behind it, I'm very pleased to see that my white double geraniums come back. This rather foxglove appearing plant is a Romania elata, which I bought at last year's plant auction. And it's just, actually I think I had it indoors over the winter. It's a bit tender.
Very nice.
But it's in amongst this erysimum, which I call winter orchid. It seems to be in flower a lot of the time.
So now we're in the back garden.
It's a back garden which is facing southwest.
Right, okay. And let's see what we've got here.
We've got Pentamen Stapleford Gem, which actually I think it was sold to me as sour grapes, but we've decided it's Stapleford Gem. Yes, these are Aquilegia chrysantha with a lovely long spurs.
They're up very late, aren't they?
The ones from America are later than the vulgaris ones. Erigeron Korvinsky Arnhem.
Right, Mexican daisy, we all love.
Yes, and it spreads quite a lot, but it's very welcome to fill in a gap. Here's something that is a bit different. This is an Antirrhinum Brom Blanketii. Brom Blanketii.
I haven't come across that.
Yeah, well, it's a sort of perennial Antirrhinum. It doesn't die away completely. I keep this lily just in this pot here at the bottom of the wall because it stays okay in the winter, and it's a Regale lily. This is a rose schoolgirl, which we were inspired to buy because Biddy Marshall had one on the front of her house.
Oh, wow. She's got it. We all have to have one.
Yes. It's finished flowering, really, at the moment.
Right.
I created this alpine bed here because I like to have a raised bed. It's quite useful to have a wall to sit on when you've got friends around. And easy for gardening into because you can stand up and your feet don't get wet. This is one of my favourites at the moment. This is Antirrhinum hispanica, which I grew from seed from a village in Spain, collected last autumn. Good. Around here we've got some lovely violas. This is a Victorian viola. It's got a rounder sort of face.
Mm.
And then there's Lithodora there, that lovely blue.
It's still going.
It's going rather wide. And the double aubretias, of course, the flowers last a bit longer because most of the aubretias are over.
Mm.
So if you get a double one, it lasts a bit longer.
I didn't know that.
You can see how these house leeks have got to the point where they're making a flower. And when you take the flower out, you end up with a hole in the middle. But it looks quite nice. It's like a crown. So I shall do that to those and we'll have some nice rings of sempervivums.
Right.
This is a rather nice tub plant which I brought last year and it stayed outside all winter. It's a convolvulus, which actually when the sun goes in it closes up, so I'm glad we can see it in its glory.
Absolutely. A very sunny day.
Yes. We've got a Solanum laxum creche du pape there against the wall. It's a very pale lilac colour, and there's a bird nesting in it.
Oh, very good.
Yes, otherwise there's a washing line which I'd have had across there, but I haven't had it out yet this year. And the bed underneath, we planted up quite quickly when we came because we'd got the space, and those are all bearded irises which just love being baked at the bottom of that south wall. And then there's a rose climbing iceberg there. Here's the Lychnis coronaria oculata. It's got the little pink eye.
Oh, yes.
And just some Dutch irises that have come through there. I've been growing some Agastache from the Hardy Plant seed list. That's Agastache licorice blue when it comes out.
Uh-huh.
And some Clary, which just come from seed every year. It's a rather nice bright blue Corydalis there. And then I've got quite a lot of these shrubby salvias.
Right.
This one is
Nachtfinder.
Nachtfinder.
Yes, the bat, isn't it? Or is it moth?
Oh, a night something.
Yes, I think it's a moth.
Oh yes, might be. Night moth.
This is a delphinium which has got a lovely purple flower. That's all I can tell you.
Okay, well, it's certainly very nice.
Yes, it's
creeping into the gap there.
Justice.
So this is Heuchera.
It's called Paris.
Right.
I think the flowers are going to last
very
a long time.
Rich colours.
Yes. This is a Stachys called Primrose Heron, and it's got yellow leaves in the spring when it comes up. But when I told a friend about it, she said, "Oh, Primrose Heron lives near me." So it's a lady called Primrose Heron.
Really? Primrose Heron?
Yes.
How bizarre. It's a strange combination of primroses and herons.
Yes. Here we've got a cistus, which I bought at a plant auction, which seems to like living in a dry space.
Yes.
Well, here's a lovely paler version of the chrysantha. Well, I've planted this salvia next to this rose because I read from an article in the Telegraph that Sarah Raven said they stop pests going onto plants. And you can understand why, because the smell of these leaves is quite strong. It might deter pests. Slug-proof pasta called...
I can't believe it. What's it called?
Devon Green.
Devon Green.
Yeah.
Slug-proof. Make a note. Thank you.
I just want to show you this foxglove. It's the Digitalis mertonensis.
Mertonensis, yes.
The strawberry one.
Mmm, lovely.
Here we've got an Anthemis E.C. Buxton, which is... It needs to be restrained, actually.
That changelog could do with a bit of restraining too. But as it became ever more insistent, we decided to visit the greenhouse.
The Morning Glory, which has produced one flower this morning from seed from the HPS.
Very good.
Yeah, and you can see that this is a foxglove factory in here. Lots of foxgloves coming. I sent off for some. In fact, I sent off for some called Campanulata, which have a big flower on the top.
Right.
And the seed, I sent off a seed, but the seed didn't germinate, so I wrote them an email, and they said, "Would you like some plugs?" So I said, "Thank you very much."
So that's Digitalis campanulata.
Yes, well, I call it peloric foxglove. The peloric foxglove has just one big flower at the top. Well, it has other ordinary flowers going lower down, but one big one at the top, and if you can take the seed out of there, you can grow some more.
Very good.
Because I rather like things that are weird.
And on that bombshell, we moved off around the corner to Rosemary's garden. Here in Rosemary's lovely front garden, there's something so exciting, she just had to tell me about it before anything else.
Okay, do you want to tell me about it?
I have to say, Brian, it really doesn't look very spectacular, but I'm so excited I needed to share it with you.
Tell us all about it.
Heptacodium. I saw it at Arley Hall. A couple of years ago, and it flowers white flowers in August, which is nice for a shrub, and the leaves are much more distinctive and hang down. And then I tried to get hold of it and found it had only been in the UK in the last 20 years, and apparently entered the country as sort of five small cuttings in a plastic bag. I'm really looking forward to it flowering, and when it's a bigger shrub and the leaves are far more distinctive, which is what really caught my eye.
Well, you send us a picture.
Right, okay. Come on through and I'll show you my real speciality. Liz has got all the special plants. I'm more into gardens as a whole, but I'm crazy about this new Echium that I've just got.
Right, well, come on through then.
Yes, great excitement. I'd seen the Echiums at a couple of stately homes and came across one last year, which was about sort of, you know, 18 inches off the ground. So it made it through the winter, and it's done all this growth in a few months.
It's massive, isn't it?
Hoping that I can actually get seed from it, which I should probably give to Liz to get going and sort of get a succession. I mean, I do agree, it's out of proportion. Doesn't belong in this garden at all, but it makes me laugh.
It's impressive.
What's more to like?
Lovely.
And it goes with your top.
Well, indeed.
So I asked Rosemary to tell me a bit about the story of the garden.
Well, when we came here 8 or 9 years ago, the garden was basically bare. But I like playing with space in a garden, and I designed this literally on the back of an envelope going up to Scotland on the train, to try and persuade my husband, who had a really bad stroke, to go out in the garden with his electric scooter and meander around. And I like the idea of pathways becoming slightly obscured at the end to tempt you around. So this is, and I like mixing the occasional bit of formality with a generally fairly loose way of doing it. So I have a sort of relatively formal water feature, bubble feature, which has different planting coming up in the spring. Since coming to Hardy Plant Society, I'm becoming much more interested in herbaceous stuff. So framework of shrubs and herbaceous comes and goes, and no particular colour scheme. Well, here it's working up to becoming a hot coloured border, although it starts off in the spring with a very pretty lilac, superbum. Anyway, so we start off with the lychnis, and then the orange-coloured Hemerocallis will come through. The dahlias, Bishop of Llandaff, although Christopher Lloyd used to refer to them as the Dean of St David's, which I rather like. So I'm quite pleased at the moment, although the alliums have gone over, but seedheads are lovely, aren't they? So we have the geranium solistemon, and I'm really excited about my foxtail lilies, the Eremeris, which have taken, I have to say, 3 years to get three spikes, but, you know, that's fair enough.
And that will get a lot bigger, won't it?
Oh, yes, yeah. Loose colour scheme here is blues and creams. I have pinks and whites in the next border, blues and creams here, which should break it up, break the colour before we get to the hot border on the far side, the far right. I don't have many special shrubs and plants, really. I just like the way they're put together. I'm rather fond of this little dainty Nepeta, which I think is Nepeta fairy something or other, but it is so dainty and very well behaved, and it works quite well with the bulbs coming up through. So this area, I've been trying for some years now to grow a wildflower area, although strictly speaking it's a pictorial meadow mix. Eventually was persuaded to actually strip off the turf, put 3 inches of grit down, and sowed various varieties of the pictorial meadow seeds, which were great. Last year I saved seed and moved it around, and I have to say the species are very much more restricted now. So next year, although it's still very pretty, next year I shall get rid of all these plants and the seeds and start again with the pictorial meadows. I know they're not pure wildflowers, but they can be quite stunning. The archway came from our previous house, which divided the main garden, hole through the hedge, which this filled, into an orchard area. So it had to come with this, I'm afraid, because it was a 50th birthday present for my husband. And I'm trying to grow the ivies along it for when these poor ropes collapse. But I think I've seen ivy grown along ropes. It works quite well given time. This is loosely my giant's border, which in midsummer is big. I'll tell you why in a minute. So this is Sanguis sorba lilac squirrel, which is just a joy. Just one flower out, at least you can get a taste of it. And then this is why this Bricotonii cortaderia is why I call it my giant's border, because I had to move with it. It was in the garden when we came, We just moved down from a couple of years in Edinburgh, and they have a lot of this Ricketonii in Edinburgh. So I couldn't chuck it out because sentimental value, and I decided that I would sort of move on to other taller herbaceous stuff from there. My son takes me away for a weekend garden visiting as a birthday present, and we went over to Wales and we went to Crook, and I found this which I didn't know whether it was going to flower this year or not, and it's been an absolute joy. 2, 4, 6, about 11 flowers, deep maroon centres, and I'm hoping that it will have offsets at the base, which should only take 2 to 3 years to flower, as opposed to 7 from seed. Time. The Phyta lacca, just coming through, should be a lot taller. Again, it came from Pippa Rackerson's garden at Ling Beaches, because I know her daughter, and she let me take some things from the garden, which was very nice of her.
Good. Good.
Yeah, the laurel marbled white, slightly rather disappointed. It obviously wasn't a good specimen. I've always grown it in several gardens, but anyway, it shields my next door neighbour, so too much green. Yes. Yeah, although it doesn't look much at the moment, Coronilla glauca here has just finished flowering. It flowers reliably from late November right the way through until the end of May. Lemon yellow flowers, and it's just wonderful. It will get, this is only 2 years old, because the other one died of exhaustion after 5 years, as they do.
Okay.
Lacanthum and goldrush, R-A-U-S-C-H, which I rather like with this touch. I don't know, something about it that really appeals.
So you've got a nice arbor there, and the clematis is?
Pearl d'Azur,
right.
And it's a nice shady place to sit, and if one angles the angle that one looks out on, one cannot see any rooftops of neighbouring houses, so I rather like that view.
Excellent.
Nothing like a borrowed view, is there?
Excellent.